The Government of the Bahamas and the Bahamas Branch of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association present sessions from the 41st Conference of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association under the theme, Modernization, an Essential Element for the Independence of Parliament and the Deepening of Democracy. The conference welcomed women parliamentarians, youth parliamentarians, secretaries, delegates, and observers from the Caribbean, the Americas, and the Atlantic region of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association. Tonight's session is Modernization, an Essential Element for the Independence of Parliament and the Deepening of Democracy.
Our first presenter is the 7th Secretary General of the CPA. He's recommended by the 61st General Assembly, made up of representatives from the 9 regions, and this is one of the regions. He is originally from Guyana, then moved to the UK. He's an honors graduate in English law, Bachelor's of Law, and an LLB in honors. He has a master's in public health, public international law from the University of Cambridge. He's a qualified barrister at law, an attorney, and admitted to both English and New York bar. A career diplomat, held senior positions within the UK, Foreign and Community Commonwealth Office, and the Commonwealth Secretariat, specializing in international law. The Secretary General succeeded the late Dr. William F. Shija, who was the former Minister and Member of Parliament of Tanzania, who served as Secretary General from the CPA from 2007 until his untimely death in October 2014. Ladies and gentlemen, fellow parliamentarians, I bring to you our keynote address from the Secretary General all the way from the UK, Akbar Khan. Let us welcome him.
Thank you very much, Honorable Speaker. I'd like to recognize His Excellency the Honorable Prime Minister, Perry Christie, the Honorable Speaker, the Honorable Dr. Kendall Major, the Honorable President of the Senate, Bailey Wilson, the Honorable Vice Chairperson of the CPA International Executive Committee, the Honorable Shirley Osborne, Honorable Cabinet Ministers, Honorable Members of Parliament, Regional Secretary, Honorable Regional Secretary Heather Cook, clerks and parliamentary staff, and distinguished guests. It gives me great pleasure to be here today in my role as the Secretary General of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association to address you and to deliver some remarks at the first plenary session of the 41st CPA Caribbean, Americas, and Atlantic Conference here in Nassau. As many of you know from this morning, I was born in Guyana. It is therefore a great pleasure and honor to be back here amongst you in the region of my birth. It is a region that I left as a young boy, but which always feels like home when I return on visits because of the warmth and generosity of its people and the wonderful hospitality. I have now been Secretary General for nearly 7 months, and following my appointment, one of my early visits on duty travel was indeed to this region, where I was warmly welcomed in Montserrat and also Guyana by the Honorable Shirley Osborne, the Speaker of the Legislative Assembly of Montserrat, and the Honorable Barton Scotland, Speaker of the National Assembly of Guyana. It was a great privilege to be back in the region to visit these two very different CPA branches so early in my tenure, and to have the opportunity to observe firsthand the diversity of the Westminster model as applied in this region, while also hearing about the current challenges facing these legislatures as they seek in the 21st century to implement the enduring political values of the Commonwealth. Distinguished guests, when I talk about the political values of the Commonwealth, I speak here of democracy, rule of law, human rights, gender equality, and good governance. And underpinning these values is the importance of the separation of powers concerning the relationship between the three branches of government, the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary, who in their respective spheres are the guarantors and the protectors of fundamental human rights, adherence to good governance, and the rule of law. Distinguished guests, the conference hosted by Bahamas comes at a very proud moment in your history, to which I offer my heartiest congratulations on behalf of the CPA. I understand that the Commonwealth of the Bahamas earlier this month celebrated its 43rd anniversary of independence, and notably its 287th year of continuous parliamentary democracy, which started in 1729. It's therefore evident that the Bahamas has a long and distinguished history of parliamentary democracy. In this context, I anticipate that during such a long period of democracy, your parliament has had to evolve and modernize to meet the ever-changing needs and aspirations of the citizens of Bahamas, as it serves also to comply with its international responsibilities in a global world. The theme that you have chosen, therefore, modernization, an essential element for the independence of parliament and deepening of democracy, is therefore very appropriate to share with other regional branches as Bahamas reaches its 43rd year of independence. The need to modernize our parliaments to ensure their independence and deepen democracy is today a common challenge and a rising drumbeat across the Commonwealth. A challenge, in my view, that is best navigated together to find durable solutions through discussion and exchange of views. The hosting of this conference is therefore to be commended on such an appropriate theme. The approach seeking solutions together is also highly reflective of the mutuality of learning that characterizes the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association, where we seek to promote democratic governance through connecting, developing, and supporting parliamentarians and their staff to identify benchmarks of good governance and the implementation of the enduring values of the Commonwealth. For the past 105 years, the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association has been at the forefront in advancing parliamentary democracy across the Commonwealth by enhancing knowledge and understanding of democratic governance, and in turn building an informed parliamentary community that is able to deepen the Commonwealth's commitment and further cooperation amongst parliaments and legislatures. Distinguished guests, as we look across the Commonwealth today, the challenges facing parliaments and legislatures, large and small, to embed good governance, transparency, and democracy, and to ensure an enduring relationship of trust between citizens and their parliamentarians have never been greater. In fact, only last week, this sentiment was echoed to me by the Lord Speaker of the Tongan Parliament in the CPA Pacific region, when he noted that the call for parliamentarians to represent, legislate, scrutinize, account, and be transparent is increasing, especially with the advancement of democracy and the rise in demand for good governance. He concluded that the survival and strength of parliamentary democracy in all of our societies depends on the ability of presiding officers, parliamentarians, and parliamentary clerks to meet the challenges and to adapt to change. Therefore, as a region, you are not alone in your aspiration to modernize and to deepen the relevance of your parliaments to your people as we proceed in the 21st century. Across the Commonwealth, parliaments are confronted by accelerating trends in modern society, which makes the need to modernize all the more urgent. The most worrying trend for some time now is disaffection and disengagement from parliamentary democracy by large sections of the public, especially the young, which manifests itself in declining voter turnout and upstanding members of society being turned off from running for elected office, or indeed any public office. This should be of concern to all of us who are committed to promoting a vibrant and representative democracy today and for tomorrow. There are many reasons for this decline across the different societies of the Commonwealth, but at least one reason that has been advanced on the evidence is a growing decline in the respect for Parliament as an institution. This sense of decline in respect for the institution of Parliament, if not addressed through modernization in a timely, sustained, and holistic manner, will ultimately have consequences for the economic and human development of all of our societies. So what then must we do as a parliamentary community to address the decline and ensure the independence of Parliament and the deepening of democracy? I certainly would not stand here and claim any panacea for all of the ills affecting parliamentary democracy today. But if I may, I will make a few humble suggestions for your conference in the course of this week. Let me start with, firstly, calling for a restoration of public trust in Parliament. Distinguished guests, Parliament is the key pillar of any functioning democracy. In fact, some of you will have heard me say on many occasions that It is difficult to imagine what kind of democracy can exist without an effective functioning parliament that scrutinizes governments and ensures transparency while promoting good governance. In order to remain relevant, parliament has to move and change with the times. Such a parliament must not be an exclusive and remote institution removed from its citizens, but rather at the heart of society, accessible and accountable to all, amplifying public voices so that national decision-making reflects the priorities of all of its peoples. Public trust in its representatives is a fundamental and core aspect of good governance. It is crucial because if parliamentarians demonstrate high standards of ethics consistent with their important public roles, especially when they are scrutinizing the executive arm of government, it enhances public trust. Good conduct is crucial as it can help uncover and deter ethical conduct, misconduct, and also corruption. Good conduct is also crucial because it builds trust and is fundamental to the effectiveness of Parliament in fulfilling its essential role of legislating, scrutinizing executive government, and representing the public interest. When there are trusting relationships between the people, Parliament, and other institutions, we all know that democracy works at its best. When people trust their elected representatives and the institutions, people know that representatives are working for them, and it helps to legitimize our parliaments and our democratic systems. In this context, let me refer to the body of work that has been undertaken by the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association to support and enhance the conduct of members of parliament, and also to promote the effective functioning of democratic legislatures to fully express the will of the people and to involve them in participatory democracy. The body of work to which I refer includes the recommended benchmarks for codes of conduct applying to members of parliament, which was published in 2015, and also the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association recommended benchmarks for democratic legislatures that were adapted to reflect the nuances of the Caribbean, Americas, and Atlantic region in 2011. In my view, these recommended benchmarks continue to provide an excellent framework for self-assessment by all regional parliaments and reflection on the legislatures across the Caribbean, Americas, and Atlantic region can rely upon these benchmarks in order to enhance citizens' trust in parliamentary democracy as they seek to modernize in order to tackle the numerous challenges facing them today. Indeed, one of the CPA branches within this region that I wish to recognize for its steadfast commitment to ensuring the modernization of its parliament is Bermuda. Bermuda in 2013 established a joint select committee on parliamentary governance and reform to ensure that the Bermuda's legislature met standards of the CPA benchmarks for this region. Using the adapted benchmarks, which reflect this region's unique traditions and parliamentary practices, Bermuda's parliament has been able to use the benchmarks as an independent platform for discussion and as a roadmap for change of what is needed to deliver modernization to strengthen its parliament. Significant reforms coming out of the recommendations of that joint select committee from Bermuda include, firstly, better oversight mechanisms to scrutinize and the accountability of institutions and also of the executive based on the principle that good scrutiny produces good government. Secondly, the Joint Select Committee recommended the establishment of an ethics committee comprising members from all political parties and also to include independent members to enforce a code of conduct. And thirdly, the Joint Select Committee recommended the establishment of a new independent body known as the Management Commission, responsible for the administration of the legislature in order to deepen the independence of Parliament from the other arms of government. It is clear that such progressive steps by Bermuda to modernize its legislature will go a very long way to strengthening the independence of Bermuda's Parliament and also deepening democracy. I'm pleased to say that the pioneering work of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association in establishing the benchmarks for democratic legislatures, which started in 2006, continues today to ensure that the benchmarks remain relevant and practical to all parliaments as they modernize and seek to be more effective and efficient as they navigate the challenges of the 21st century. A significant challenge for all parliaments, and especially small island parliaments, which reflects the growing complexity of the international agenda that many of you face here in the Caribbean, is how to translate the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, or the SDGs, into concrete action for all citizens by 2030, so that the dream of no one being left behind can be fully realized by 2030. A specific goal of the SDGs is Goal 16, and this goal is directed to the role of parliaments in society as the institutions of governance, which requires them to be effective, accountable, and transparent, so that the decision-making is responsive, inclusive, participatory, and representative. The 2030 Agenda is a powerful call to action that aims to strengthen governance and democracy across all of our parliaments in the modern world. The effective functioning of modern parliaments is central to meeting the goal of the SDG Goal 16 and the aspirations which have been set out in the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. I'm pleased to inform you that in partnership with the Westminster Foundation for Democracy, UNDP, and the World Bank Institute, the CPA will again lead pioneering work to identify the responsibilities of modern parliaments in promoting good governance, transparency, and accountability arising out of Goal 16, the outcomes of which will then be used to update the benchmarks of democratic legislatures in order to reflect Parliament's unique and central role in building effective institutions to meet the requirements of the 21st century. Let me turn to say something about the importance of representative parliament in deepening democracy. Modern parliament must also be a representative parliament. It must make itself attractive to candidates from all walks of life, and that must include younger people, women, and persons with disabilities. Many Commonwealth parliaments unfortunately continue to have the culture of a men's club. Unless the structural and cultural barriers to attracting women and other underrepresented groups, including the disabled, to parliament are dismantled, we will continue to have unrepresentative institutions which lack legitimacy to make any decisions on behalf of the society which it seeks to represent. In order to address the key issues of equality, diversity, and inclusion, some parliaments have established women and equalities select committees. These committees can help identify and provide durable solutions to overcome the barriers to attracting a broader cross-section of society into parliament, whether as parliamentarians or as parliamentary staff, to enhance the legitimacy of this central institution to our national life. Today, in a changing world of responsibilities, where the traditional roles of men and women are breaking down, and societies have a legal and moral obligation to promote diversity and inclusion for all, parliaments must also adapt if they are to remain relevant to the societies which they seek to serve, rather than holding fast to practices that appear to many outsiders to be frozen in time. Practices such as late-hour sittings, uncertain and irregular parliamentary calendars, unchecked discriminatory language and unprofessional attitudes towards women and other underrepresented groups, a lack of any appropriate or adequate institutionalized resources to assist members with representational functions who may work and live in different locations, the absence of any creches or nurseries for those staff or members with childcare responsibilities, structural barriers preventing wheelchair access to and from buildings, or the absence of facilities for persons with sight or hearing impairment can all act as barriers to deepening democracy and as a barrier to attracting candidates from underrepresented groups. Let me say a few words, finally, about the importance of information communication technology as part of your conference theme. The use of ICTs can be significantly implemented to improve and strengthen outreach to the public, as well as improving the efficiency of Parliament's business. We now live in an era of accessibility and transparency, of instantaneous communication and advanced technologies. Parliament has a range of ICTs at its fingertips to enhance the workings of an institution, both in terms of the relationship with the people it seeks to serve, but also to drive internal efficiencies in the way in which it operates. In modernizing our parliaments, we must seek greater transparency as an outward-facing institution using a variety of social networks to connect with people. In December 2014, the CPA and the Commonwealth Telecommunications Organization, the CTO, hosted a parliamentary session a training session in Trinidad and Tobago, which delivered a workshop on the use of ICTs and how they can assist a modern parliament to link in with constituents. The conference highlighted the need for making information more accessible via web-based technologies or open data and through the use of social media, which in turn enables greater participation of the public by transforming them from recipients to participants. The real challenge that I see arising from the digital age is to ensure that the new electronic technologies and the skill to communicate in them does not become a social divide between Parliament and the societies which they seek to serve, especially the young. There is a real risk of a communication divide arising between those who use the newer communications tools and those who remain stuck in the traditional systems of communication, such as oral communication and email. There is a pressing need for all parliaments, their staff and parliamentarians, to invest resources not only in newer technologies, but to receive appropriate training as to how to use those newer technologies in order to reconnect with a younger generation, and to hear their voice, which in turn can contribute to better and more inclusive national decision making. But it's not just connecting with the younger generation that is important. The use of newer technologies can also help strengthen democracy through promoting greater public access to parliamentary proceedings, whether that be live streaming of proceedings in the chamber or committee work by access to parliamentary reports, educational outreach materials, or simply by encouraging a more interactive consultation by the public on policy development. Likewise, the use of ICTs to create document management systems to support the legislative process can also promote greater internal efficiencies for all users. I've outlined a number of challenges facing Commonwealth parliaments today that clearly make the case for modernization to support their independence and to deepen democracy. But before I close, let me celebrate some of the positive developments in this region, which should provide us all with encouragement as we embark on our discussions on how to strengthen and modernize parliamentary democracy. There are several very positive developments to showcase, but given the limited time, I'll limit myself to a few. Firstly, the establishment of the Caribbean Network of Public Accounts Committees, known as CANPAC, following the inaugural meeting of Public Accounts Committees of the Caribbean region in Trinidad and Tobago last year. The importance of development to support parliamentarians to better be prepared to ensure effective scrutiny through parliamentary committees cannot be underestimated. In fact, the evidence shows very clearly that better oversight through the use of parliamentary committees and scrutiny of public finances leads to lower incidences of corruption as well as wastage. Grenada, Trinidad and Tobago, and Guyana have all exceeded the 30% target set by Commonwealth heads of government in reaching women's participation in political life, and they should be applauded. But I make the point, this is a floor, not a ceiling, and we should all be aspiring to do much better. Grenada is also entering into a dialogue with a view to establishing a national human rights institution compliant with the Paris principles as a result of its universal periodic review process. And that is a very important development which we should all applaud. I also want to touch upon the development of interregional twinning arrangements between Canada and the Caribbean, Americas and Atlantic region to strengthen legislatures. I think this is a very important layer of support, which is complemented also by CPA and other actors. In conclusion, parliaments can and do change over time. For all their flaws, parliaments remain central to a nation's identity and to its national life. It is precisely because of their importance and centrality that from time to time, it is vital to step back and to reflect on how they are functioning, and to ask whether they still remain relevant and fit for purpose in the 21st century. Failure to modernize and to reform risks Parliament becoming an irrelevant institution in the eyes of the public, which in turn damages democracy for all of us. The late former leader of the United Kingdom House of Commons, the Right Honourable Robin Cook MP, once remarked, "There is a problem of legitimacy for a parliament that does not change as fast as the society it represents." Those of us who believe, with all its faults, that parliamentary democracy is the best and most accountable form of government must prevent this from happening. In closing, I wish to thank you, Honourable Prime Minister, and also the Honourable Speaker for inviting me to address the audience this morning. I also wish to thank this audience and all of the colleagues who've assisted me in being here in the Bahamas, and particularly the clerk and his team and the Regional Secretary, Heather Cook. It's been a great pleasure being here, and I will reflect very much as I leave Bahamas tomorrow on the generosity and warmth of Bahamaland. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary General. Our second distinguished presenter is the Honorable Frederick A. Mitchell, Member of Parliament, Minister of Foreign Affairs and Immigration. Minister Mitchell has been active in public life in the country since 1975. He's worked as a journalist and as a lawyer by profession. Prior to his appointment and election to the office, he was an activist, human rights movement in the Bahamas with special interest in the judiciary and South Africa. He served the Senate in the Bahamas from 1992 to 2002, and now a member of the House of Assembly in the Bahamas. He was appointed Minister of Foreign Affairs and Public Service in 2002 and served until 2007. The portfolio was later expanded in February 2006 to include foreign trade. He's a graduate of Antioch College, Yellow Springs, Ohio, the John F. Kennedy School at Harvard University, Cambridge, Massachusetts, and the University of Buckingham, United Kingdom. He served as chairman of the Senate Select Committee on Culture. He's serving his third term as Member of Parliament for the Fox Hill constituency, having been first elected in 2002. This is also his second stint as Minister of Foreign Affairs and is now the Minister responsible for immigration. Fellow delegates, ladies and gentlemen, fellow parliamentarians, let's welcome our Chief Diplomat of the Commonwealth of Bahamas, Frederick Mitchell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and good afternoon to you all. I have to first offer an apology because I have to leave almost immediately after I'm finished this to go to the airport to catch a plane. And I say that because the leader of the opposition was making much about travel without support and explanation, but it's my job and I gotta go. So forgive me, please. I also wanted to reflect on the words that were spoken before me, but to add words of welcome to you all here to the Bahamas, and I do hope that you find this a useful and enjoyable visit. As you heard from the speaker, I've been in this business now as a public official since 1992, so that makes 25 years if I survive to next year. And one of the things I've been thinking about as this five-year term comes to an end is what can I really do in terms of legacy building? And I think one of the more important aspects of that legacy building can in fact be what we can do to improve the relevance and legitimacy and the support of the Parliament that we have. I'd like to use two points extrapolating from what the Secretary General just said. And that is this question of how do we get the public at large to commit to Parliament and to supporting Parliament as an important institution. I reference two issues which now face us in the Bahamas. One is the whole struggle about the question of right, freedom of speech and access to the Parliament, which is usually captured under the rubric of parliamentary privilege. And the two that survive in the Bahamas are just those two, the right of freedom of speech and that of access to the Parliament. A few months ago, a judge of the Supreme Court purported to issue an injunction in the Bahamas to prevent parliamentarians from speaking about a particular subject in the Parliament. This was an extraordinary event, and the public seemed to enjoy the fact that a judge had issued an injunction, and the litigants on the other side of the divide indicated that if the parliamentarians spoke in Parliament, they would be subject to a contempt hearing in the courts and therefore be sent to jail. In the current thinking in the country, it's popular to stick the government in the eye or to stick parliamentarians in the eye. We're sort of lowlifes of the country. When in fact, there is not a recognition that the people who represent the people who are members of parliament are no better or worse than the public that they represent. And so if parliamentarians are considered lowlifes, to use that expression, then what does that say about the people who elected them? So that's the first point. People think, it appears, it's the current fashion, that the privilege of freedom of speech and the fact that you are protected in speaking in parliament is a privilege which is personal to members of parliament, as if this is something we need to have and need to enjoy to hold it over the rest of the population, when in fact it is a privilege which attaches to the constituents themselves. It is for the constituents' own protection, so that a member of parliament is free to stand up in parliament and speak on behalf of the people who that member of parliament represents freely, without having to concern him or herself about the legal implications in the libel laws, in particular, in speaking in parliament. And that's something which is for the protection of constituents themselves and to support the work which parliamentarians do. But, you know, the fashion is, let's take away the privilege without thinking about why it exists and the reason for that privilege. Part of this, I think, Secretary General, has to do with the fact that we perhaps need to do a better job of public education about the functions of public life and what the role of public officials they play. I often say that, you know, you have to explain to people that political parties exist for a reason. That's the way you mass mobilize. That's the way you organize people behind objectives. And if you didn't have political parties, you'd have to invent them, because that's just the way the system works, and it works fairly efficiently. But there is this disconnect, which many of the speakers before me have spoken about, and I think public education is perhaps the answer to that. Some of the programs we use, of course, are the youth in parliament, so that you have young members of parliament, actually young aspirants to parliament, actually come and have the experience of speaking in parliament and knowing what it is like to be a public figure. I think that you have to have even more formal training for people who want to be members of parliament so that they actually see what the job entails and the kind of life you actually have to lead in the public domain. The current fashion is, again, that public figures have no private life. It used to be, when I was a student at Harvard, that they taught us in the classroom that your private life is only in the public domain if it touches and impinges on your actual work. Today, all of that is out the window, and the new atmosphere is anything is fair game. Anything to sell newspapers, anything for a headline, and of course, the social media is unqualified, no fact-checking, there is no redress in effect for anything that is said in that domain. I was thinking as I was listening to the Secretary General about what then can we do, more than just the general public education where you get on the television or you invite people to come to the House. And I was thinking that one of the things we can do in the Bahamas is, you heard the Prime Minister speak about the fact, and the Speaker himself just spoke about the fact that we need a new building. We had a parliamentary select committee which unanimously agreed on certain things that had to be done to support the work of members of parliament. And it got derailed immediately because the press honed in on one aspect of it, which is the inadequacy of the salaries for members of parliament. You know, that's a very popular topic as well, as you know. We said that you needed to have offices, you needed to have the technical support, you needed to have secretarial support, all of that to enhance and support the work of parliamentarians. Very unpopular with the public. And my feeling, again, is this is not something that you should ask the public. My view is we should just go ahead and do it. Most likely you do it after you get elected, shortly after you get elected, so you can absorb the shock as it goes down the road. We also indicated that we needed to have a new building, as I said, and the estimate of a new building for us would have been about $50 million. Now, I've been to Antigua, and I've seen this wonderful structure that they have in Antigua. I visited the Parliament in Barbados, which has been retrofitted to provide much of the things that we're asking for. I've also seen the Parliament in Malta, which is an amazing edifice. And I've been a witness to the back and forth in the UK over the billions of pounds, which it will take to repair the Palace of Westminster, which is actually sinking into the mud because it's on the riverbanks and the flood tide is overtaking it. But this is something that must be done. And I was thinking, as the Secretary General spoke here, that what we need to do is to commit to this building. And the young people build the building, design the building, build the building. And perhaps by their actually being involved in this massive public infrastructural project, they can actually feel a part of something which belongs to them, because it's actually being built for them into the future. And so that's one of the things I'd like to recommend to my colleagues as a way of tying young people into the project of Parliament and the need for Parliament to exist and be supported. On the parliamentary privilege point, my own view is that, again, we need to explain to the public why this is necessary. And my feeling is that in our own country, we should pass a law which would invalidate any order by a court which purports to hold a member of parliament in contempt for violating an injunction. I think the law is clear on the point now, but it perhaps needs to be made clearer, and I would certainly support amending legislation to make that clear and to vacate any such judgment which is made by a court of law in that direction. So those are some of my ideas. I welcome you again to the country. I thank you for coming here, and I just want to quote Horace Mann, who was the founder of Antioch College in the United States, who said that you must be ashamed to die unless you have done something which is good for humanity.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Honorable Minister, and he has indicated, as he said before, that he has to catch another flight. Matter of fact, he knows many joke about his travels. Sometimes we hear a plane flying by, and they said that's Fred. And so, but you know, like he said, he gets paid to fly. So the Honorable Minister would not be available for question and answer or commentary, but certainly the Secretary General is here, and the floor is now open. We're running out of overtime, so we'll allow just a few questions. Or comments, and Mr. Tynes here has the microphone. One thing that came, just before he, regarding this notion of disrespect, I got a chance to experience that firsthand, although I kind of let it roll off my back as the pleasantries that come with the job as a politician. In a barbershop experience, when I sat down in the barbershop and reading my newspaper, and a gentleman in the chair was lambasting politicians, and the barber felt a little bit concerned about the well-being of the Honorable Speaker, so he was trying to get the gentleman to quiet down a bit and just, you know, play it off. So he said, "Well, they're not that bad, you know, they're okay." You know, he said, and the guy in the chair said, "No, they're bad. There's teeth, there's lie, and I don't trust them." And I'm sitting there in the newspaper, and I'm putting it up over my head so that, you know, I'm trying to stay out of this one. And he goes on and on. And at the barbershop, the barber decided that he's going to take a chance. And he said, "Well, I'm sure you're not talking about Honorable Speaker Dr. Kendall Major." And the gentleman in the chair said, "Who, him? He's the worst of the lot." So, you know, there you have it. We can't win for lose. And so I get the wrath of being a politician and the life of a politician. And then secondly, and this occurred at the meeting, so I certainly would like that address, the meeting we had yesterday in the executive committee. And a question was asked of the CWP chair, and that was, why do you need a constitution in CWP? And I think that ought to be addressed, aired out a little bit, and illuminated for those, Speaker Osborne, I'm sure you'll be very much interested in that. But I'll turn the floor over to former Speaker Mark Wade from Jamaica, from Trinidad and Tobago, now Senator Mark.
Yes, thank you very much. I, I wanted to thank the Secretary General of the CPA for his contribution here earlier this morning, in fact this evening, this afternoon rather, and to indicate what would be his advice and recommendation to parliaments and parliamentarians as it relates to actively participating in the oversight, supervision, and ultimate implementation of Agenda 2030 and the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. Because he made reference to Sustainable Goal number 16, accountable, accessible, and other principles as it relates to the role of Parliament. So that's the first question I want to ask him to clear up for us. The second area I would like him to clear up for us in terms of challenges, which I did not hear mention, is the absence of financial and administrative independence of our parliaments, not only here in the Commonwealth Caribbean, but even beyond these shores. That's the second question. And the final area is parliamentary privilege. I would like, if it is possible, that the judgment of that Supreme Court judge be circulated for the edification of all delegates so that we can understand, you know, what may have informed his thinking, because clearly it is out of sync with reality. So we would like to know what would have informed the thinking of a Supreme Court judge to actually trespass on the legislature, when we know that the legislature is independent of the judiciary. Don't mind my business, I would mind yours. That is what the principle is. So those are the areas, Excellency, I'd like to have clarified.
Thank you very much, Senator.
Thank you.
Secretary General.
I'll take it from here. Well, thank you very much, Honourable Speaker Wade. I'll take the questions in turn. On the SDGs, as you quite rightly say, I mentioned Goal 16. Goal 16 talks about establishing effective institutions, of which Parliament is one of the effective institutions in any society. But you're right, there are 17 SDGs, and my view around the role of parliamentarians in implementing the SDGs is that the SDGs have been agreed internationally. Now the challenge is for national governments to implement and to translate those commitments into concrete outcomes for their people. And as such, each government has committed to delivering those goals for their people. And therefore, I would expect that is central to Parliament's role to hold governments account to how they're going to take forward the implementation of those goals through a proper action plan, because this is going to take quite a lot of work in terms of mobilization of resources, also bringing in civil society and other stakeholders in the implementation of the SDGs. Now, I'll give you one example of where this is being done really well. Already, in Pakistan, the Pakistan National Assembly has spoken to UNDP and other stakeholders and are working with UNDP and other stakeholders to put together an action plan as to how the Parliament of Pakistan or the National Assembly of Pakistan is going to take forward the implementation of the goals. So they're actually getting ahead and doing this. And I think it's absolutely essential for everybody to start to think about how to do this, because the time is already ticking. There's 15 years to 2030. The goals have already been agreed. Governments are already committed to delivering this. And it is the central role of Parliament to legislate, to ensure that resources are allocated in order to take all of these goals forward so that we do reach 2030 and no one is left behind. So absolutely, it is Parliament's role to do this. And absolutely, all parliamentarians have a place to play and to take forward those goals. And I do hope that it doesn't become an issue whereby people start to, or parliamentarians on either side of the floor start to dispute the goals. The goals are agreed. That's uncontroversial. What may be controversial is about how you prioritize which of those goals and how you allocate resources at a time of considerable austerity for many of us with regard to those goals. But I also think, because the SDGs build on the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals, all of the goals will not apply in terms of the degree of work that has to be implemented to take them forward in the same way. There will be, you know, it's a very mixed picture in every country as to what progress has been made according to which goal is required to be implemented. So I think, firstly, you've got to do that assessment, and you then have to prioritize as a country which are the goals you're going to take forward. But that call for action is absolutely now, and the clock is ticking. So yes, I completely agree with you. There's 16. I talked about goal 16, but in fact there are 17 goals, and you need to do that assessment, and you need to talk about a national action plan. But how you bring in the expertise, how you allocate resources, what are your priorities, and where you are actually as a country in relation to progress against each and every one of those goals. So that's what I'll say about that. The other question you talked about was around establishing an independent parliamentary administration. Now, I talked about the benchmarks for democratic legislatures, and one of the benchmarks is, in fact, have an independent parliamentary service administration. Of course, I think the question you're raising is that in many of our Commonwealth legislatures, there isn't an independent parliamentary service. Civil servants seem to get moved backwards and forwards across different ministries. Parliaments do not have control of their own money. And as a result of that, this is fundamentally a breach of our benchmarks, but also it impacts on the separation of powers in terms of Latimer House principles. I would encourage everyone to take a look at those benchmarks and particularly follow what Bermuda has done and to see whether it is time now, if you have not got an independent parliamentary service, to see how you can achieve that in line with the benchmarks and, in fact, the spirit, if not the letter, of the separation of powers, of the Latimer House principles. On the last question, I'd rather not be drawn on that. Obviously, as a lawyer, I think one needs to read the judgment before one can actually take a view on it, and I haven't seen the judgment.
Thank you very much, Secretary General.
My question is about the judgment, because as a lawyer of some longevity. As an attorney of some longevity, I found that judgment, which I had read very briefly, I have not been read the entire judgment, but just the principle of the judgment and the actual finding, to be an act of lunacy, and clearly cut across the separation of powers. What I want to know is, has the government, I think it was the government and the builders or whatever, has the one of the government applied to have the injunction struck out? And if not, is that before the court? And is the government intending to take the matter to the Bermudan Supreme Court if it hasn't reached there yet?
Very well.
Because it is a very shocking decision, in fact.
It is, and I will certainly be guarded in the matters. It is still before the court. I am advised, actually, that by the end of the month, which would be this week, perhaps while we're here, the judge is to give a ruling.
Same judge?
The same judge.
What?
Is to give a ruling.
Oh, it's an interlocutor.
Because the matter through the Attorney General's office and Dr. Lloyd Barnett, who represents a number of the members of Parliament, who was cited in the affidavits, she is, the Honorable Judge, is making a determination and a ruling on by the end of the month. That's my understanding. The Parliament has carried on unfettered. The Speaker has spoken to that very publicly. There was an issue initially with respect to a select committee being recommended to investigate some of the nuances and the details of what caused this in the first instance. And in that resolution, it spoke to the judge being possibly hauled before the court, hauled before the parliament at the bar. That caused much consternation with the judiciary, and there was a meeting of the minds, and it was best, and we determined to just leave that one alone and continue the separation. So that's where we are. Yes, I wanted to ask, just before you, a member for Marco City, who's a member of the House of Assembly, who spoke very strongly in the House about the ruling, my ruling, and also the judge's ruling, and I think he would be great to bring some context, because as I stand here today, I would certainly be biased.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Good afternoon, everyone. Let me say it. I am a member of Parliament, but I'm also an attorney of and a barrister of some 25 years standing. And so I was as shocked at that ruling as I think most of our Commonwealth parliamentary colleagues are. Let's give a little context, factually, and then in terms of the jurisprudential framework in the Bahamas. Factually, this started off as a, let's call it a private litigation matter between some very well-funded antagonists. And what happened in the middle of it is that reference was made to certain persons in the House. And those persons in the House, quite properly, I think, came into the House to defend their privilege and to make mention in defending their privilege of certain email communications and to take issue with certain things mentioned in those email communications. That's as far in the factual background as I want to go in. In the jurisprudential background, we have a constitution that makes it clear that the parliament makes its own rules, governs its own rules. We also have the separation of power that makes it very clear that the three arms of government ought not to interfere with each other. And I think finally, we still have the Commonwealth, the common law concept of contempt of parliament to the same extent that we have the common law concept of contempt of court. And so this is the very crisis, constitutional crisis, that is to be avoided by not having these wrestling matches between the three arms of government. And so I stood up in the House to make it very clear that although the party that the members were who were challenged in the public domain and who were defending themselves in the House is not the party that I belong to, although that is so, nonetheless, I stood up to defend and to encourage them not to bow to the court on that issue, and if necessary, to assert our privileges in Parliament all the way up to our contempt of Parliament privileges. Some would say calmer heads prevailed. I do not think that this is one of those things that we negotiate. I don't think this is a matter of civility and a matter of persons trying to find a diplomatic solution. This goes to the very fabric of our democracy and the fabric of our constitution. So I wait with interest to see what ruling this judge would give. I am disappointed to see that the Chief Justice did not marshal this case very, very quickly onto the Court of Appeal to simply have a reversal through the judicial process of what that judge did so that we did not have to address it through the legislative process. And I think that's unfortunate. I think that was the proper course, that her ruling ought to have been appealed immediately, and a higher and more sober court ought to have dispensed with that ruling, thereby preserving the separation of power and not causing Parliament to put the courts back in their proper domain. So this is a real constitutional issue for us. We're not taking it lightly, and I would not want our colleagues in other jurisdictions to think that to the degree that we are not marshaling ourselves in the streets over this, that we are taking it lightly. We're not taking it lightly. We understand this to be a constitutional issue. I've called it in the House a constitutional crisis, and I just want to reassure everyone that we are taking it very seriously, and I look very much forward to the next ruling to see whether the judge has come to a senses yet.
Thank you, Honourable Member. Just to add context to what the Honourable Member said, he's a private member, he's not a member of the governing party, and he's a leader of a third party. So I thought in context it was important that he spoke up in support of what was said. This speaker, as long as I'm sitting in the House, will not relent. The House will carry on unfettered, irrespective. We could cart us all up to jail, but the members are only subject to its own rules that comes from the chair, period, case closed. Yes, member.
I want to get to something which is also, I think, important for us to recognize. You were talking about being in the barbershop, and you were talking about the gentleman that carried on. And I just wanted us to reflect on one another side of it. At least that gentleman was speaking and speaking up, and he was prepared to speak.
Absolutely.
But there's some issues that I think we have to start to recognize of individuals out there who are very concerned. Yes, I agree. But they have taken now, we all make ourselves accessible, but they're not just writing emails, they're writing unsigned letters,
yes,
and the letters start
yes.
to attack, not, they don't express concerns about the process, they start to make this personal. And the reason I'm saying this, because you see things that are happening in other countries where people believe this lack of respect, this belief that all of a sudden they're supposed to take it into action. And we don't need to have persons blurring the line between saying I'm concerned to decide that they're going to do things, personal attacks against individuals which result in harm, etc. So I believe that if we don't start to say to people that you can express your concern about the process, you can write your name on a document so that somebody can reach out to you and make everybody aware of your concerns, but we're encouraging a system where people just write letters, unsigned, and then if you can go that far, you can actually take that into actions which might be very harmful and very detrimental. And what the Secretary General said about why people choose not to go into politics, why people believe that they don't want to put themselves out there, it's further extended. It's being extended more so each day. We don't need a UK example. We need to turn around and have the mutual respect in the House, the mutual respect in our all of our interactions, and I think we need to focus on that.
Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. I'm Jomo Thomas. I'm the Speaker of the Parliament in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. I wanted to ask my friend who from Bermuda, from Bahamas, yeah? Was there any law that the judge cited in order to come to the decision that she cited, that she came to? Because the conversation as to whether there's parliamentary privilege and how far that should go has been a debate for a long time. At least I have read things where people have talked about it, so I am rather surprised to hear people say that it is almost sacrilege to raise the issue at all. So I really wanted to understand what was the law that the judge cited to do what he or she did.
I'll allow the member to answer.
Thank you.
That. But it spoke to the secrecy, the privacy, rights of privacy within the Constitution, and also the data protection. I think the legislation and data protection and the rights of privacy in the Constitution. Member?
To answer you, the court was guided or persuaded by three cases outside of the Commonwealth jurisdiction. And said that they found those cases, she said she found those cases to be persuasive. I don't have the case names to my head to just cite, but I didn't find them to be persuasive. And in fact, they are quite contrary to numerous cases out of the Privy Council dealing with this point in terms of Caribbean and Commonwealth jurisdictions and so on. If I could just say one thing, though, I don't want to leave the wrong impression here. There is a different side to this concept, which is not when we are saying something that, when something is said about us that offends us, or the judge does something else that offends us, but I just want to introduce into this another concept I'm going to bring tomorrow, which is this idea of the House of Lords having recently changed a law regarding what they used to call fair comment on a matter of public interest, meaning when it's us now that affects, when people are saying bad things about us. They recently changed a law to honest comment on a matter of public interest, which is basically to say public officials grow a thicker skin, you know? And if this type of assault had come from private individuals who were just saying things about MPs, I'd say look at what the House of Lords has said in terms of honest comments on a matter of public interest, that when it comes to us as public officials, people are justified, even if they're not right, so long as they honestly believe what they were saying. It changed the law completely. It's about 10 years old now. and that to be in the public domain, we have to balance our sensitivities against the demands of democracy. The challenge here is not that something was said about individuals which was simply untrue or disfavorable to them, but it was done by the court. And when the court does that, when the court issues an injunction against Parliament, it goes beyond any pale of what is allowed by, under the guise of having a thick skin. It moves into the area of the court itself saying what cannot be said in Parliament, a prohibitory injunction. And if the court can do that, it can say what can be said in Parliament, a mandatory injunction. If the court could tell you don't say this, it could also order you to go into Parliament and say that. And that is troubling. I mean, this is not a new thought. This is a thought that's about 400 years old. And our jurisprudence is clear on this, that this simply cannot be allowed. So yes, some cases were cited. They were unpersuasive to me. I think they'll be unpersuasive to most people. And I would invite the court, or look forward to the court correcting herself on the next occasion.
Much. Final question. Yeah, we expect this case to be thrown out, no doubt. I sleep very good at night. I'm not worried about it. Yeah. Final.
Thank you, sir. I guess I just wanted to comment on separation of powers. And indeed, in Bermuda, we have seen quite a few things happening. I can say a few years ago, when there was pending legislation, the Chief Justice of our lands decided to make public comment via a local media regarding his thoughts on the legislation, which had not even been debated in the House of Assembly. And I shared that with members at BVI. I don't know if they remember. And it was met with much chagrin, because there seems to be this move of, yes, where the judiciary is beginning to more frequently interfere with what goes on in the legislative domain. And I think that it is something quite important that we definitely need to arrest that and make certain that, I guess, education has to happen there. It seems that the judiciary has forgotten about separation of powers and that they are not to enter into the domain of the legislature. And I also want to say that within the powers of our institution, the legislative institution, you have the executive versus Parliament as a whole, and indeed members within Parliament seem to forget the role of Parliament itself in terms of oversight and holding
much.
The executive to account. So I think we definitely need to do something on that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we've set the stage for the rest of the session. Thank you so much.